morning. On our election report today, we have three of the commanding women figures in the entire campaign. Pat Carney, running in Vancouver Centre again, likely to be, almost certain to be, the Tory Energy Minister if and when Mulroney wins. Iona Campagnolo, running against Chuck Cook and who is the President of the National Liberal Federation and who certainly made her mark during the leadership campaign and since. And of course, the staunch NDP MP from New Westminster, Pauline Jewett. We are not necessarily going to concentrate on women's issues this morning, because these women are involved deeply in all of the major issues in this crucial campaign to run the country of Canada. They're each going to have a separate segment, and then we shall have them together to have a quiet, scholarly discussion on the possible outcome of the election. First, after the break, it's Pat Carney. Pat Carney is running again, and it's not necessarily an easy victory for her in Vancouver Centre against Dan Hertog and against Paul Manning. What was your majority the last time, Pat?
About 1,600 votes.
And that's traditionally a three-way split in that riding, is it not?
Well, the first election, 1979, I won by 2 votes and lost it by 95 on the recount. And I think my margin in 1980 was about the same as Ron Basford received before that. I mean, it's a swing riding.
They tell me Vancouver Centre is the one place where special interest groups can really add their weight to elect a specific candidate. Is that correct?
I don't think that is the case. I don't know of any special interest groups who, you know, selectively target a candidate. All I know is that as the MP for Vancouver Centre, I have really tried to work with all of the groups in the riding, and I think I have support from most of them.
And what do your polls tell you? Manning tells me he's running second. The NDP say they're running second. Are you really running first? Tell me your polls. I hate these polls, but are you sitting here absolutely confident that come the week after next, you'll be sworn in as energy minister?
Well, I'm not sure about being sworn in as energy minister, but I am comfortably optimistic that I will be re-elected as the MP. But we're, you know, we have to keep working. That's on the basis of my own door knocking.
You were the finance critic.
Right.
One thing that baffles me, a non-partisan observer in the middle, how the devil were the nation's finances in the ghastly state they're supposed to be in, and we get this from all around, all of a sudden your boy Mulroney comes out and says, here's another $4.2 billion, but says nothing about increasing taxes. Is this political sophistry of the worst kind? He knows perfectly well that we're in a bad state, and yet he's matching almost promise for promise. And when he brings out his list yesterday, he leaves a lot of his principal costs of his promises out.
Well, I don't think that that is the case, because I've reviewed the list of commitments that he's made, and they're pretty well in line with the caucus commitments that we made in our policy review. I mean, we've spent the last 10 months going through all the estimates and identifying what changes we think we can make. The energy changes, of course, involve the refinery tax, and it involves the fuel tax for loggers and fishermen.
Was that included in the calculations,
oh,
the
yes.
fact that you're going to lift the petroleum and gas tax?
No, those cancel each other out. The ones that we talked about yesterday, and what I call the pre-throne speech, I mean, it says the things which will be introduced in the first major throne speech of a Mulroney government. But the energy components, just as an example, include the elimination of the fuel tax for loggers and fishermen and primary producers, and the elimination of a refinery tax. Those are very concrete measures which will help our primary producers and help our energy industry. But what you asked me about the other taxes, there's really a neutral fiscal impact. The changes on one side of the balance sheet will change on the other.
You see, I'm just stupid.
No, you're not stupid.
I don't suppose. I mean, there they say we're going to wipe out billions of Liberal waste.
That's
true.
But
you know as well as I do, the only way you can wipe out these billions of Liberal waste is to do a Bennett, isn't it?
No, that's
not
true.
Cut and slash, fire the civil servants, get rid of all the inefficient, unnecessary programs.
That's not what the Auditor General of Canada says. The Auditor General of Canada says that we can get more value for the money we're spending by more careful management.
But you can't do that in time. You know how long it takes to move one civil servant.
Well, because we have to start. The Conference Board of Canada says that we'll lose 100,000 jobs this year alone if we continue the way that we're managing our resources.
But you think you can do that quickly enough to be able to spend an additional $4.2 billion without increasing taxes?
Yes, we call it productive management.
Sounds like pie in the sky, doesn't it?
Well, why don't you see? Because we're convinced we can do it. We're convinced that we can make the necessary changes. Just, for instance, in the attitude of civil servants. If you can promote and reward civil servants on the basis of how much money they save, not how much money they spend, that's a start in the right direction. And if you can cut out duplication of programs, which are all over the estimates, obsolete programs, John Turner himself said that there's billions of dollars wasted, and he found another $300 million on a telephone call for you.
$300 million is petty cash nowadays. I mean, $50 million.
$300 million dollars is a lot of money, and we're very, very stingy with taxpayers' money.
What is the secret deal made by your party with the premiers to keep it on, what was it? You lived a lovely little face, a quiet little accord. Now that makes one terribly suspicious.
There is no secret deal. That is the usual standard trumped up charge of the NDP liberals, you know, who see paranoia under every corner and under every rug. There is no secret deal. What there is a cooperation between myself as the energy critic and all my counterparts in the provinces for the last 10 months. In the evolution of our energy policy, I have worked carefully with the premiers and the energy ministers of the producing provinces like Alberta and BC and the consuming provinces.
Are you telling them what you're going to do to help them?
No, we're saying, what are your problems? What are your problems and you know, what changes can we make?
What
and the secret and the way it worked out, the proof of the pudding that cooperation and working together and talking to each other works is the fact that I was able to negotiate the offshore agreement with the Premier of Newfoundland, Brian Peckford, when the Liberals couldn't for 2 years.
The details of that have not been given out.
Of course they have been. They have been distributed by our party to all the press. There's 18 points in that agreement.
Yes, and does that mean British Columbia will get all the West Coast oil resources if any are found here? If we find Hibernias, will we get the same generous deal you've given to Peckford?
If we are
the
government, if we are the government, of course. I have to keep BC in mind when I'm negotiating an offshore agreement for our party and for Brian Mulroney, because of course I'm a British Columbian. But basically the whole core of the agreement with Newfoundland is to treat Newfoundland equal, treat Newfoundland as Alberta is treated, as Saskatchewan, and say, you know, they get to manage the resources if they owned it.
I'm sure you understand my principal theme. All the way since the election was called, the nation's in a ghastly mess. The deficit's awful.
Well, you know, you can't have it both ways.
But then all of a sudden, both Turner and Mulroney, forget the Broadbent, Turner and Mulroney, suddenly both of the major parties find massive billions that they didn't know about until they began to get into the promised bidding act.
Jack, the last time I was on this show, you were saying we had no policies. I mean, you Tories don't have any policies. Now you're all saying we have too many policies. We said we would would tell you about our policies, and we told you that we'd tell you what the cost was. And we're telling you how we're going to finance them by replacing certain programs, by eliminating waste, and by better management. I mean, you should.
Sounds wonderful.
Well,
I want
we'll
to ask you a newspaper reporter type question. You're a newspaper woman, and you can give me a yes or no answer to this, because it's the kind of thing that makes little headlines and people don't forget. Will Mulroney do a Bill Bennett with the civil service?
Absolutely, totally not.
He did say we shall have universality for those in need. There'll be no cuts. For those in need. And that kind of rang a social credit type Bennett bell in my head.
No, the $40 billion which is in the social envelope cannot be touched, as Flora MacDonald said, you know, as recently as yesterday. That money is old age pensions, family allowances, unemployment insurance. There's no room there to cut it.
Things are not too generous.
No, we are committed to Medicare, we're committed to universal pensions, and it's only the other parties, you know, who say don't trust them, And we say, don't trust them. It's the Liberals and the NDP which have had the hidden agendas.
You
and it was the Liberals who brought in the NEP.
You would agree with me, of course, that you are a quote, put saying nicely, a red Tory.
I'm a conservative.
You're a progressive. You're a
I'm
red.
A progressive conservative.
You're on the left of the spectrum.
I am a progressive conservative.
You couldn't enjoy yourself sitting for dinner with Sink Stevens, for instance, could you?
I have often had dinner with Sink Stevens, a very charming, nice intellectual man.
A bit of a right winger.
Well, we have some very spirited debates, Mr. Stevens and I.
Now, in Vancouver Centre, Broadbent sat here yesterday and told me that they wished to take the body house section out of the criminal code, and I told him that means you want the private sale of sex and houses anywhere, but not in Robinson's writing. He was the guy who brought the policy to the surface. What do you think?
He lost his job for that, too.
He lost that one job as critic
yes.
of justice. What do you think of Mulroney, of the NDP policy to remove the body house section from the criminal code, and do you agree with me that that in effect would authorize the sale of sex in private homes by hookers?
Well, of course, I always agree with you, Jack.
No, seriously.
No, seriously, I want to address and have been addressing the issue of street soliciting. I want to have the sale and the you know, the buying
and
the selling
pandering.
Of sex off the streets so that the neighborhoods are kept quiet and for the use of their residents. Last night I was down in the West End at a Shame the Johns reunion, where I was very pleased to be honored by the Shame the Johns committee for my work on behalf of the West End and all of Canada in cleaning up neighborhoods. But until we make the changes in the criminal code to deal with street soliciting, all our neighborhoods are open to that kind of threat.
Well, let me not mix you up with Broadbent in any way. Your position is that the criminal code should be amended quite simply to make simple soliciting by customers or state people an offense against the criminal code, wiping out the Debbie Hutt case.
Right, but it's customers as well as prostitutes. It's the offer to sell and
the offer to buy.
Particularly in residential neighborhoods. And it's, in a public place which is defined as private places open to public view, apartment foyers.
Yes, back lanes, foyers,
et cetera.
All the rest of it.
Yeah.
Pat Carney is going to stay around for the panel with my other political guests. Next this morning, Iona Campagnola, National President, Liberal Federation of Canada, and a power in the land after the break. Last time I saw Iona Campagnola was at the Liberal Leadership Convention in June. And I was the guy who asked John Turner if he had guts enough, I think I said, to run on the West Coast. And he is running on the West Coast, as is Iona, of course, which was expected. Little background first, though. You were the MP for Skeena.
That's right.
For how long?
5 years.
5 years. When were you defeated?
1979.
So you haven't been in since then?
No, because the guidelines say once you are a defeated cabinet minister, you can't make a living in anything you learned while you were a cabinet minister. So I went back to broadcasting, as some of you might remember, mm-hmm. with a television show for 2 years. Was living here in Vancouver, so moved to the North Shore, and I've been living on the North Shore for 5 years.
They say that there was a bit of a tussle between you and John Turner, and you were a little upset because you couldn't make it nowhere to run because he was very slow in deciding if he'd run in Capilano or in Quadra.
That's Alan Fotheringham's journalistic entertainment.
Listen,
it's
if I'd known that, I wouldn't have asked the question.
Nothing to do with the truth. I was not running in Capilano. I was a resident of North Vancouver for 3 of those 5 years, and I happened to buy a little condominium 20 feet away, which put me across the border. But if I win this election, I'll sell that little place and buy one right in the riding.
In the riding. Was it a mistake to run Peters and Clark's, to run, to run John Turner, the Prime Minister, in Bill Clark's riding in Quadra?
No, I don't think so. And that's where Mr. Turner feels most comfortable, where his family roots are, and it was his choice. And I think he's going to win there.
Oh, but how can you possibly say that except for
because
sheer puffery?
No,
sheer
Jack.
Puffery.
35% of the people there are still undecided, 4 or 5 days before the election. That means to me that they are thinking very strongly about voting for a leader. And I can't see British Columbians turning their back on a party leader when it will put some power into this province, which we've never had since 1896.
Let me give you the interpretation I put. I think it was to Mr. Turner. Are you now campaigning or advocating that voters in Quadra would be better to elect a leader of the loyal opposition than an undistinguished, somewhat dull backbencher. Is that what you're now telling on this camera?
Don't put words in my mouth. I don't know whether he's undistinguished or I don't know whether he's dull. I have no idea what he is. Well, but I do know Mr. Turner is distinguished and definitely not dull and also will do a great deal for British Columbia in whatever capacity. And if he turns out to be leader of the opposition, if that's the case, he won't be that long because I think his qualities of honesty will eventually win over the Canadian people.
But that would be an automatic line now because he can't win, can he, in Quadra?
I don't think you're right, Jack. I think he will win in Quadra. I think the people of BC want that kind of power. Whether it's a leader of the opposition or a prime minister, I think we in British Columbia have done without power at that level for far too long.
1,500 votes Cook won last time, and Gordon Gibson was close to him, wasn't
he?
That's right.
That
was a 1,500.
Gordon was second, yes.
You think you can take Cook?
Well, I have worked very hard. I think the people certainly realize I'm there, and I am hopeful I will be able to win the election. I never count my chickens before they hatch. I am a good, strong candidate. I will represent North Vancouver-Burnaby well if I'm elected. I think the people know that.
Did you not embarrass the new prime minister by, you're not in the cabinet, of course, but by your sudden declaration, which started a flurry, on an independent course of action for Canada on the nuclear freeze?
Certainly not sudden. Everyone in the party knows that I have been a world federalist for years, that I have been opposed to the cruise, which I opposed the very day that the party put it out, the government put it out. I also asked them, when they asked me to go and speak at this debate, if they were sure they wanted me to put my position forward. And not only that, I consulted with Mr. Turner, with Mr. Chrétien, and with others. They knew exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah, as a backbencher, of course, you're free to express
your... I'm not even a backbencher.
No,
I'm not bound by cabinet solidarity. I'm not bound by party secrecy.
Mm-hmm. But, of course, if you're in the cabinet, you'd be bound to accept the traditional view of any Western cabinet that if you were to arbitrarily declare a nuclear freeze or refuse to test the coups, we'd be in great bad order with our allies in NATO.
But, Jack, don't you think it's proper and appropriate that the people I'm asking to vote for me know where I stand on these kind of issues? And when you say that about NATO, you're quite wrong. Both Denmark and Greece have voted in the United Nations for a nuclear freeze, verifiable, multilateral, and in the case of Denmark, a bilateral freeze, two votes in the UN, plus four other nations in NATO have refused to vote against a freeze. Therefore, there's a possibility of Canada to work together with our allies to debate, to negotiate, to talk to our friends, the United States, for their good and for ours, for a better world.
Have you been unfairly dogged by the abortion people, the pro-life people? Does it embarrass you at all?
They have put out their scurrilous yellow sheets, which have gone from being just on the abortion question, which I don't mind because that is their choice and I feel that they must have that right.
You're for freedom of choice.
That's right. But they've also added now these sheets that have no name on them are bringing in all the issues of the anti-women's equality, that someone like me is dangerous to society because I will indeed cause women to become equal, which they seem to oppose. All of those issues from the Phyllis Schlafly school of anti-feminist thought have been placed into the argument. So, you know, on that issue you have people who are sincere and dedicated people opposed to abortion anytime. Those I respect. You also have some partisan people fanning the flames for their own purposes, and you have plain old-fashioned misogyny, hatred of women, being put into the mix.
Don't misunderstand my question. What are my bid this morning for the women's vote if the Liberals were to become?
What are you bid? We don't do business like that. Women are different than men.
I'm talking about parties, not about women. There's been nothing but political bidding throughout this entire campaign, and Broadbent, of course, it seems, would you not agree, has led people by the nose.
But after all, Ed Broadbent is like an Olympic athlete who wins the bronze medal before he ever comes out of the starting gate. He knows where he's going to finish, and he's known all the way through the campaign, so he can promise anything.
I suppose so. Anyway, the one thing you're all agreed on is that eventually, if and when we can afford it, there will be homemakers' pensions.
CPP, as we see it now, the bigger problem is the money, of course, $900 million the first year. But how to make it fair? If you have a woman who is a homemaker and working, and or else working part of her life and a homemaker the other part of her life, how do you make it fair so that it, first of all, advantages the lower-income Canadian?
Yeah, right at the moment, where there's a two-income family with both persons working, they're both contributing to Canada Pension Plan, and they finish up on retirement with their old age pension and the CPP.
That's right.
The ordinary guy whose wife's got five kids and she had no skills or didn't go out or chose to stay at home only gets the one CPP.
And she should not be penalized for that. But to make a system fair, you know, one of the reasons women get such low pensions, Jack, is because women generally make about 60 cents on the dollar that a man makes. So they go through 30 years of their life. And even if they work all that time in the working world, they still only have about half the pension that a man has when they get to the end of the road.
It's wonderful that everybody should get everything, but none of these things are practical in Canada at the moment because of the disastrous state of the economy.
Well, we have a $30 billion deficit, which Mr. Turner has addressed repeatedly throughout this campaign. Obviously, we have that deficit because during the recession, 81, 82, we had the worst recession depression since the dirty 30s, and we have held people up in that period of time. Now, the 200,000 more people working this year than were working last year, they're paying taxes. Yeah, there will be a tax increase in October if we're elected. We're not shilly-shallying on it.
But is the public not entitled to be almost totally cynical about all of you, plaguing all your houses? This dreadful depression, the interest rates, the possibility of inflation, deficit haunting us, inefficient government, and whammo, out come the promises from each and every party.
Sure, the promises
who
have come
out. Who believes whom?
But in at least on our party throughout this entire campaign, it hasn't been the sexiest campaign as far as we're concerned.
Because no Trudeau or
Ad. We put a program out and we put the dollars after it each time it's been announced throughout the whole campaign. I suppose some people think that's pretty boring stuff, but I'll tell you, it's been completely, thoroughly honest.
It's kind of sad for you, isn't it?
There you were,
riding high, the party, riding top of the polls, 46 points or something you had.
10
points after the after the leadership. And here you are now dragging. It looks like at best you're going to have a rump-tight Pearson Parliament of the 62.
But look what rose out of that. One of the best, longest-serving party dynasties we've ever had.
Do you reckon it's time for the Liberal Party to suffer an opposition and be reborn anew like Phoenix from the ashes?
But you know that I do not believe that, because we're halfway through the reform process, led by Gordon Gibson, by the way, of this province. We are into the interim phase now, and all the reform members are observing this campaign for future changes in our constitution and organizational structure. That will come in about the end of this year. In 1985, we have a special convention on the full reform of the party. I think that's going to be very good for the party. It can be done inside government or outside government. You don't have to be defeated to be able to do that kind of work. We have to post-industrialize the Liberal Party. It's out of date.
If you're elected, will you keep your job as national president?
I will, if I'm a backbench MP, because the Tories president, Peter Elzinga of Pembina, is a backbench MP. But I wouldn't collect the salary, of course, and I wouldn't work full time at it. If there was any conflict, if it became too onerous a duty, I would give up the presidency.
My thanks to Iona Campagnolo. She'll be back later in the program. Next, Pauline Jewett, MP, NDP, New Westminster. After the break. Pauline Jewett is the external affairs critic of the NDP, up to now anyway, and she runs in New Westminster-Coquitlam. Used to be New Westminster alone, didn't it?
Well, it's gone through various manifestations. Burnaby was also part of it.
Your big specialty, of course, is the nuclear freeze. And I suppose the NDP has been constant in its position about a nuclear freeze since day one, has it?
Yes, it's been absolutely constant. The idea of the nuclear freeze really originated in the United States and was picked up very strongly there by a very, very large popular movement. In Canada, it didn't come quite as soon as it did in the United States, because our focus at that time was almost entirely on refusing to test the cruise missile.
And you're one of the people who admire Trudeau for his moves towards a peace initiative, don't you?
Like all Canadians, I admired the Prime Minister for taking that peace initiative, but I did feel it was, as the saying goes, too little and too late, that he could have taken it much, much earlier in his period of time as Prime Minister. It would have been far more valuable had it come earlier, and that he shouldn't have done it simply alone. It's better, for example, right now there's what's called a five-continent movement with the presidents and prime ministers of countries from five continents that are moving toward and working toward a nuclear freeze. I would have thought it would be better had Mr. Trudeau joined those leaders, Olive Pammy, Indira Gandhi, Andreas Papandreou and so on, in a larger joint effort. I think it would have been more effective.
Mm-hmm. Does the NDP really, has it ever said bluntly, let's get the hell out of NATO?
Yes, the NDP policy is that we shouldn't belong to a superpower-dominated alliance, and what we would like to see is smaller and medium-sized countries like ourselves.
Denmark.
Denmark, of course, has been very independent in NATO, and but we would like those countries to come together, in a sense, almost as a third force, because we think the world is tired of the two superpowers running the nuclear arms show.
Well, I've bowed in your direction as the perennial critic of foreign affairs for the NDP. But Ed's got away with murder during this campaign, hasn't he? Knowing that he can never, ever be prime minister of the country this time round.
Well,
and he just stands on the sideline, throws in 50 million for rent relief, 600 million for daycare, 900 million for homemakers' pensions, a billion for this.
Well, what is so interesting, Jack, is that the total amount of the election campaign promises that Ed has made and the New Democrats have made amounts to less than either of the other two parties. Fewer dollars. And indeed, in all fairness, I think the New Democrats, who may well one day form the government of this country, have been very responsible in this campaign, you know, in terms of what they say they think is the highest priorities, what needs to be done, and what it will cost.
Do you feel now that the NDP is not fighting the Liberals anymore, but is fighting only the Tories, and that the Tories are fighting you, and that the Liberals are an almost totally spent force?
I wouldn't say that entirely.
You wouldn't?
No, and certainly not in British Columbia.
Why? Because of Quebec, of course, where they're bound to get 20 or 30 or maybe even 40 seats.
No, I think it'll be almost an even split probably in Quebec.
That's
I think Quebec and Ontario are going to be very dominant in the Conservative Party. I think British Columbia, you know, we're fairly independent, and I don't think we necessarily are going to just follow some kind of a bandwagon, Tory or any other.
I'm told you'll be lucky if you hold your 11 seats in BC.
Well, I'm looking at the 11 plus three more.
But you're fighting the Tories more than you're fighting the Liberals, except perhaps in Quadra and North Vancouver. Is this the beginning of a two-party system for Canada?
No, not entirely. I think the chances of the New Democrats gaining seats are very strong. The chances of the Liberals losing seats are very strong. The chances of there being a sort of reforming of the political party system, you know, are fairly strong too after the election.
Mm-hmm. Now, what about your interest in post-secondary education? All of us ordinary people who haven't had the benefits of fancy educations seem to think there's an awful lot of money wasted, and we don't spend much time weeping over our universities. Where are we wrong, and what would the NDP, if it ever got power, do about it?
You know, I find people talk about education more than anything else, because the young people are getting such a double whammy. On the one hand, they can't get jobs, mm-hmm. and on the other hand, they can't because of high tuition fees, because the SOCREDs have abolished grants, they can't get into universities and colleges. And it's a very serious situation, and it's their parents that are talking about it even as much or more than the young people.
It's allied with the jobs, though. If we've got 500,000 youngsters between the ages of 17, I think it's 25, 524,000, without any jobs, perhaps the only thing to do is to keep them in school or keep them in education and try
but I'm saying that they don't have the opportunity to go on into college or university.
Does Bennett's
because of the cutbacks. And because, quite frankly, the money that the federal government does give over to the provinces, it gave a 6% increase this year, is not passed on to the universities and colleges in the province.
Mm-hmm.
And
Bennett steals the money.
That's right, that's right. It goes to some other purpose entirely. And I had an amendment in the House of Commons that increase in the cash transfers should go to for the purposes intended. That was an amendment, it was perhaps symbolic, but to get through the idea that when the federal taxpayer is paying for money to go into university and college education, that it should be going to that purpose. And I didn't get either the Liberals or the Conservatives to support that amendment.
Okay. Increase my awareness about women's rights. I'm fully aware of the need for equality. I mean, I may put on a little act now and again. I'm fully aware of the need for equality. But I get so upset about the poor guy with the sick wife and the four kids who doesn't get a word of comfort in this while we go on about equal pay for work of equal value, and we go on about unlimited daycare for the middle class, which
let
is what you want to do.
Let me tell you about...
You want to give daycare for people that can afford to buy their own.
We want to give daycare on the same basis that Medicare is provided, and we think it is just as vital. But Jack, let me tell you about...
Just a minute. Universal daycare.
That's right.
Universal daycare.
Yes. Yes, you see, the workforce is going to be half women by the turn of the century.
Many of the workforce are going to be unemployed.
It's 40% women now. But let me tell you about one person who I was talking to the other day, a man who is unemployed, was put off his job about 9 months ago, and his wife is working. And he has discovered that she is making about 60 cents of the dollar that he would have earned. And for the first time in his life, he said, I have really realized how unequal our society is and that we've got to do something about it. They're living on her paycheck. She's doing comparable work to what a man would have gotten almost twice as much money for.
Well, in the federal civil service, you and the liberals, yes, would cure that at once by just upping the wages, wouldn't you?
You see, when you go into equal pay for work of equal value, what you're doing basically is reclassifying your jobs.
That's right.
And that would take, you know, a really concerted effort to do
Unfair
it well.
Unfair though it may be, it'll cost billions.
Some of the back payments that have been made in the United States have cost billions. I don't think it would be that high here.
Don't you get disgusted when you see the millions? I noticed the liberal in Manicawaga, whatever it is, has put $270 million in federal grants into that riding where Mulroney is now running.
Well,
look at what Axworthy has spent in Winnipeg. It's untold billions, millions. What do you get in Westminster?
I find this almost distasteful, really distasteful. It's bribing, really bribing people with their own money, saying, you elect me, this is a conservative saying, you elect me, and I'll be on the government side if we form the government, and I'll be able to bring all these goodies to this constituency. Andre Ouellette brought $6,000 per voter to his riding. Axworthy brought whatever it is per voter.
Oh, God knows.
I just find that whole thing is a real kind of violation of the democratic
And we
government.
Haven't even talked about the stench of patronage, have we?
Well, of course, we'd abolish the Senate, and that'd be one way of getting rid of some of the patronage.
You have to buy them out, cost millions. Might be worth it just let them go to the reward one at a time and then close the doors.
Okay. You could call it gradual abolition.
Good. I'm going to ask your other two candidates to come in and have a free-for-all discussion with people on the phone and yourselves. And returning after the break will be Pat Carney and Iona Campagnola with Pauline Jewett. Well, candidates, I can't say ladies. If I say ladies, it sounds patronizing. So I'll call you Pat, Iona, and Pauline. Fair enough?
Okay.
Fair enough? We'll call you Jack.
You call me Jack. Or you may call me Mr. Webster.
No, then we'll have to call you a gentleman.
Are you ladies full of sweetness and light to each other, or would you care to have a bash at any one of you from any other of the ones?
Well, that's difficult, really, to say. We are all politicians, and there are, from time to time, differences among us.
And you all belong to the same club, and secretly you're all terribly nice to each other.
Well, there was one or two occasions in the House of Commons where women did cross party lines.
Yes.
And, for example, on the amendments to the Indian Act, we did cross party lines and support those amendments.
And in terms of getting daycare on the Hill,
yes.
That was another example where the women MPs all joined forces
to
help establish.
I trust you pay the full economic cost of daycare on the Hill.
It's user cost on the Hill. But
and
it's open to everybody. It's open to everybody.
And that was also when the Speaker was a woman as well. So, sure, there are occasions.
And does it apply to the servants on the public servants on the Hill as well as the MPs?
Oh, yes.
It's open to anyone who works on the Hill.
Is it lush and lavish?
No,
it is not at all.
It's very utilitarian.
What does it cost?
Depends on what your income is.
Well, MPs, it must be a standard price for them. This is a good news story. What does it cost an MP, father, man or woman, to buy daycare on the Hill?
Well, I believe it's the same for everybody on the Hill. But
do you have to figure,
ma'am? My child is too old for daycare. I'm glad to pay for daycare, if it's available. I think it should be available.
When our children were small, there wasn't any daycare per se, and certainly not licensed daycare, which we now have in this country, and hopefully we'll have a lot more of.
I'm going to go to the phones this morning because I'm kind of exhausted. I'll be back at work 3.5 days.
Poor Jack.
It's really quite tough.
Try running an election.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. I would like to ask the three ladies about the immigration. Will there be some restrictions put on not to allow families bringing their relatives?
Okay, ma'am, I'll put the question for you. It's not a very good line. Where do you stand on unlimited family unification, relatives, fiancés, fathers, mothers, fiancés, fathers, mothers? Where do you stand on unlimited family unification?
I don't think the woman's question was not on unlimited family
unification. Yes, it was.
Our party's stand is that we give a high priority to family unification, particularly, for mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters. But we have to gear our immigration policies to the state of the economy. And when, you know, constituents phone me and come to ask for our help, we say, well, if you can't bring your family in now because there just simply isn't the jobs for them, there isn't the housing for them, we'll have to improve the economy and
immigration has been a lot less since about the mid-70s, but we still believe that reunification of families is very important, and we just recently passed a directive that would allow daughters and sons 21 years of age and over to rejoin their families. That's a new part of the Immigration Act.
If I can just put that clearly, any remaining daughter and son.
That's right. Yes.
To automatically.
Yes.
But there is no limit to family unification. In other words,
as long as they're close family relations.
Mother, if an immigrant comes in, they bring in the fiancé. No, but you go to fiancés and the fiancés' families, and more male children than the fiancés' families.
As long as it is fairly and equitably divided, we are not a racist nation. We make it fair.
There should be no limit on it. You agree with that too?
Well, our definition of the family is quite different from the definition of a family in many other countries, and where it's a very extended family that includes, you know, an enormous range of cousins. I think it should be our definition of the family.
Well, I just want to tell you, ladies, that while I don't raise these subjects deliberately on there, it is a matter of considerable concern for ordinary people.
Sure it is.
And everybody sits back and says, well, it doesn't matter. There are people who say that your unlimited immigration policies puts an incredibly heavy strain on our very expensive Medicare system to the detriment of people who have been
here
a long time.
They are not unlimited immigration problems, programs in the first place. And in the second place, Jack, I think we have to remember that all of us are immigrants. We seem to forget that.
No, I'm only relaying a question.
Even you, Jack.
I am only and I came here to get away from my
family.
What
kind of people would we be if we arrived here and closed the door after us?
And if there were any more second or third Webster cousins, we'd have to think hard about letting you in.
Yes, we certainly would.
As long as they could do a job no other Canadian could do, like Jack.
Thank you, Iona Campagnolo. You won a friend, supporter, and admirer.
It's true, there isn't another one. Oh. Can you tell me there's another one of this man?
Oh, I know, he's got enough ego now.
I should hope not.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, you mentioned with Pauline about the student loan, but I'd like to hear from the other two. This overhauling of the student loan program is long overdue. If we're going to have about $50 million in delinquent loans, there must be something in the way we handle our education for our people. Why in the world are they paying a loan, prime rate plus 1%, 13.75%, about $5,000 a year? At the end of 4 years, they have a $20,000 debt, they have a degree and no job, declare bankruptcy, and this seems to be a rotten setup for people that want post-secondary education. Let's quit it. Start free education.
Say that again.
Start free education, she said. You know, the federal level of the government puts in $4.5 billion a year into post-secondary and training systems, and those dollars are funneled down to the provinces. In the case of BC, in the last 3 years, BC has received $1.7 billion in post-secondary. Our government was looking at the possibility of directly funding the individual students rather than going through the provincial government because so much of the money is funneled off in other directions.
No.
Well, I think you can start with, as Pauline says, you can start by having the money that's voted by Parliament for post-secondary actually spent in this province on post-secondary. I think it's wrong that we vote money for post-secondary, and it's a Conservative position that it's wrong that we vote money for post-secondary and it's not spent in this province on post-secondary.
Well, I wish you'd supported my amendment to that effect. On the question of loans and grants, however, it is a terrible burden for a young person to come out with $20,000 to $25,000 in debt. And we must have an adequate grant system for those in need. And it is a shocker that there is no longer a grant component in the post-secondary education in British Columbia.
You mean Bennett took away the grant component?
Right.
Jack, there is a province which shall be nameless, but it's a Tory province, and there are 8 of them, so you can take your pick, that has used post-secondary money for paving of highways.
You don't mean BC?
I wouldn't say.
Well, there are no Liberal provincial governments.
No, just right wing all across the country.
But I would like to point out that we're going to be faced in this province with actual decreasing enrollment in the post-secondary in
our
universities. Yes, we are now. We're doing it this year because the kids simply cannot afford to go into HOP for $20,000 or $25,000 and then come out with no hope of a job.
So go ahead, please.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies. Good morning, Jack.
Good morning.
I have a short statement and a question for Ms. Carney. Ms. Carney, I never heard you speak out after Bill Bennett got elected and after his July 7th budget. I heard Ms. Campagnolo and I heard Pauline Jewett speak out both against Bennett and for their own policies, and how he was not doing the best things for British Columbia. But I never heard you say really anything. You stayed out of the woodwork, and being a Vancouver Centre, representing Vancouver Centre, and I'm a constituent, and I'm a constituent that voted for you in 1980, Mr. Bennett has not done anything for me, even though I do agree with some of his economic policies. Well, he has done nothing for me.
Well, what do you want from...
Yes, I mean, I'm running for the federal seat.
What do you want
I'm
from
Carney?
What do you want from Carney?
I'd like to know why she has stayed so quiet in regards to Mr. Bennett's policies and how they affect the people of her riding.
Well, first of all, I haven't been quiet, but more importantly, Brian Mulroney, the leader of the Conservative Party, spoke out against Mr. Bennett's method of instituting his changes. He has said...
Do you think Bennett followed up?
Oh, I think that
Do you think Bennett very nearly
followed
that?
Are you going to allow me to answer,
Webster? Oh, yes, if you'll answer.
I think that he could have achieved his goals in a much better way for the people involved. I think he was very ruthless in the way he arbitrarily applied the hatchet. I think, you know, through cooperation and through setting goals and saying we're going to cut spending, but it'll be done in cooperation and it'll be done in some planning, we could have achieved the same results in this province without the heartache and the problems and the despair.
But your leader said he was going in the right direction.
Yes, he did.
Yes,
he praised,
everyone
him.
Everyone has agreed that we can't have expanding...
The Fraser Institute school has to be eradicated
have to pay
from the
for
country.
It, Pauline.
The Fraser...
No, the Institute
in the
School of Restraint.
Oh, yes. What's the name of that fellow who used to be well-known in this province?
Social engineering by economists doesn't
work. What was his
work.
Name? What's his first name?
Michael.
Oh, yeah, Michael Walker. He used to be a big guy.
He's gone back to Newfoundland, I hear.
For a holiday.
Social engineering.
After the break. My guests now, of course, are Pauline Jewett, NDP, New Westminster-Coquitlam, Iona Campagnola, North Vancouver-Burnaby, and Pat Carney, Vancouver Centre.
Right.
You had a quiet campaign in Centre?
No, I think we have a very high-profile campaign in Centre. We're canvassing and mainstreeting and...
Go ahead, please. Pick your target and go ahead.
Yes, I'm interested in the patronage question and the Senate.
Well, let's start with patronage. What's your question?
Why, rather than do away with the Senate, why not make it a medium for representation of the different regions?
Can I start?
Well... That's what it was originally intended to be, was a representation of the different regions.
But what did it become, Pauline Jewett?
Well, because the Prime Minister has the sole authority to decide who goes in the Senate.
It became a sinkhole.
It became a sinkhole for his
pattern.
Tired politicians.
What a laugh. You know, when Joe Clark was Prime Minister, in 3 days he appointed 9 senators. I see a whole lot of hypocrisy in this question. If you want to clean up patronage in this country, let's do it at every level, in every party. Let's start with Bill Davis in Ontario. You want me to list you 45 people in Ontario who have been patronized by
Bill
Davis?
Well, let's deal with the...
And just 1 minute. There happens to also be a complete reform of the Senate report that this gentleman can get simply by writing to the Senate. It proposes a regional and an elected Senate, but I also think that there is a lot more going to be said about that, but we have to worry about the possibility of the Senate becoming a second House of Commons. Will that downgrade the House of Commons?
Well, I find the Liberals are always very sensitive to this issue of patronage and don't like to talk about it unless they're forced to, but I think that Brian Mulroney's proposal that leading appointments in government should be vetted by a parliamentary committee is really the only way to go. You know, if you had an Bryce McAsee, for instance, who had to appear before a committee an all-party committee of the House and show his credentials for being the chairman of Air Canada or an ambassador to Portugal, I think that that would discourage some of the smellier appointments that have been appointed.
For judicial appointments and senior ambassadorial appointments that are coming outside the public service, mind you, I think they should come within the public service, but those coming from outside should go before an all-party committee.
Boards, commissions, I have no objection to that. I think the Prime Minister should keep the right to appoint lieutenant governors, governor general, and probably the Senate until it is changed. But, you know, when you look at this particular question that's been roaring on, if you want to talk about hypocrisy, talk about Pat's leader and his two-faced statements on patronage. One of the reasons he wanted to be rid of Joe Clark was he didn't do enough patronizing while he was Prime Minister.
Oh, I agree.
My leader publicly apologized for joking about patronage. Your leader has never, ever apologized for the patronage, and Joe Clark was defeated partly because he didn't do enough patronage.
But
no,
right.
He left.
Let's
he
just
when
have
he was,
right.
You know,
was.
There was a there
let's
was
just
a,
have
no
both
Pauline.
Get rid of
no
patronage.
Pauline.
No, we can't leave patronage here. Let me bring it back to the political realities of life. Is it not a fact, Iona Campagnola, in your heart of hearts opinions, that the stench of patronage was the first thing that kicked Turner right in the teeth, that secret letter, and Trudeau saying arrogantly, and I called in the caucus to make sure he kept his word. That secret letter and stench of patronage, not only from McAtee, was your biggest kick in the teeth.
Really, and I think it was only McAtee. The other ones everyone can make a decent case for, including Eugene Whelan. Anybody with a fair mind will make a decent case. If they'd been spread out over 6 months, there wouldn't have been any problem with it. Because it was done at that moment, yes, I think it
was. The way it was done.
Yeah. Well, one-sixth of the Liberal caucus, one-sixth of the MPs, Liberal MPs, who sat in the House with Pauline and I, went on to their higher reward. Well, you know,
some
given
of
the names
for 53.50 a week, and, you know, they're talking about great patronage rewards. Some of them have four meetings a year. You know, they're trying to make it sound like vast amounts of money.
No,
lots of them are not.
But pretending we're doing a thing the day after the election, any serious observer would have to say.
I agreed. And so did Mr. Turner in his way when he was on your show.
Yeah, because I put it to John Turner that Portugal doesn't accept McAtee. Would you give him another job?
He said no.
Not from me, sir, he said.
Well, he shouldn't have given him
Well, then I
job.
Must ask you the question. Why did Trudeau, knowing what the effect would be, insist on this humiliating demand on Turner?
The one on McAtee I cannot explain. The rest of them are explainable as far as I'm concerned. Mr. Turner and Mr. Trudeau both wanted to have a new start. And one of the ways is to ask people who could quite, you know, Alan McKechnie and the rest of them, they could have said, I can win another election. Why should I quit? I can win again. And they wanted to have a new group of people in. That's one of the reasons behind it. You can't really say to someone like Alan McKechnie, who's given, shall I say, the best years of his life, unquote, to that life in Parliament, and then say, all right, go home to Cape Breton now, we're finished with you.
Why not?
For Debaney? Debaney was the most incompetent fisheries minister that this country's ever had.
What did he get?
Well, he went to the Senate.
Little Debaney. Pierre.
Yeah,
but, you know, we got a Senate appointment in British Columbia, and it was a damn good one, and I don't hear anyone praising it.
But why should there have to be this system of rewards? And Mulroney is going to do the same thing. You give your service as a member of Parliament because you want to give your service as a member of Parliament, not because you expect some appointed job for the hereafter.
Well, some people do, some people don't.
Who is the Senate in British Columbia?
Senator Len Marchand.
Oh, of course. Yes, yes.
Well, that was the Senate appointment that Iona was supposed to get, if you remember, and it went to Marchand.
She didn't take it.
You mean you refused it?
She did not take that appointment.
Well, I'm asking you, were you offered the Senate appointment and did you turn it down?
I decided that the person who received this appointment is the best person for British Columbia.
Were you offered it?
Yeah, you can see the whole thing's a mistake.
She won't say that she was offered it. I'm asking you, were you offered a Senate appointment? Now, the Liberals, years ago,
It's perfectly obvious to anyone who observes the political scene what was going on there.
Okay, you were not offered the Senate appointment.
Say what you want, Pat.
It's what you're saying.
Thank you for doing my job for me.
I too was offered a patronage job once, and I turned it down.
Patronage is a way to get people out of the way sometimes.
You were a Liberal MP.
I was offered a patronage
job. What was the job?
It was on the broadcast regulator agency at that time, the BBG.
Oh.
You know, the Board of Broadcast Governors.
Before we get to CRTC.
And I thought, boy, would I ever get Webster? I better take it. And then I decided not to.
Webster should go on that one.
Mark Raines took it instead, your colleague.
Well, that was many years later.
Anyway, let's just get out of this.
Well, one big Liberal wig, I don't suppose it'd be fair to... Yeah, David McLean, he picked up, four boards or something?
Look at the money that goes into it, too. It's absolutely incredible. And you know, Pat, I mean, Mr. Mulroney is going to do the same.
Most of them don't.
One at a time, please. One at a time. You're saying Mulroney will follow the stench of patronage in the Liberal style.
He's already said last year that he would.
That is not true. He has publicly said, I mean, this is, again, an example of the NDP can say anything, promise anything, because they don't have to live with it. Mr. Mulroney has said that those appointments will be vetted by an all-party parliamentary committee. And that's where you will be able to go and voice your reservations should you be re-elected.
Senior boards and for senior outside ambassadors. But it's nothing to do with Senate patronage.
Enough.
It'll be Tammany Hall North. You wait and see.
Subject closed. We'd all agree that the stench of patronage has handicapped this campaign, and all of you now promise to be
as pure as the Vestal Virgins.
We always have been.
Oh, yes, you've in never
memory,
given them out.
In memory of Joe Clark, yes.
In memory of Joe Clark.
The man who had 140 appointments on his desk the day his government fell and who felt that he did not have a mandate to fill those posts.
Joe Clark, where are you now?
A decent
when we need
man,
you?
Destroyed.
Yeah.
Just by Webster.
Maybe the same will apply to John Turner, who's only been back in the picture 3 months, 4 months.
I don't think so. John Turner's going to be around for a long, long time.
Speaking of Joe Clark, who's going to be External Affairs Minister if the Tories form a government?
Your lovely courtly friend that takes you to dinner?
When I'm Prime Minister, then I will make the appointments but not in the Webster show. But in the meantime, I will leave it to Mr. Mulroney to decide who will be his External Affairs
Minister. After the break. No, I'm going to take. I was just accused by a caller of losing control of this program. Let me tell you, ladies, it's a gentleman. It's a pleasure. So if you wish to hit each other or scream at each other, please feel free.
Why don't you throw in the clawing of nails and other sexist remarks?
It was right on the
pulling hair. That's a good one.
It was right on the tip of my tongue,
trained.
But I didn't say it. Okay. You said it.
Trained like Price.
I have a little trivia question here for you this morning. Good morning. Is that Mr. Barton?
Yes, it is, Jack. How are you?
And you're speaking from Dees Lake.
I can't hear you too well. Can you speak up a bit?
No, he's from Dees Lake.
You're speaking from Dees Lake.
Yes, we are.
And Dees Lake is in the Skeena riding.
Way up north.
Way up north. And what was the political question you asked me yesterday?
First of all, I'd like to know who is running in Skeena riding. Of all three parties. Apparently we can't get too much literature on it.
How many people live there? 400 people. How far are you away from anywhere? You would know, Iona, wouldn't you?
Yes, it's on the Highway 37 between going up from Stewart to Watson Lake. And your candidate for the Liberal Party there is Elmer Derrick. Elmer Derrick is a native Canadian Indian. First one to run in Skeena.
Who
He's
are the
a very
other
good
candidate?
Politician.
The candidate
and
for
Jim Fulton.
The New Democratic Party is the sitting member of Parliament, Jim Fulton, who has been one of the strongest NDP members of Parliament.
Very strong for the environment, not so strong for Skeena.
And the candidate for the Conservative is Alan Shepherd. I'm sorry I didn't know it either. Alan Shepherd.
The next member of Parliament for Skeena.
The next member of Parliament for Skeena.
Right. Mayor of Port Edward.
He's the mayor of Port Edward.
Yeah.
Well, that's about. And you're telling me you've had no campaign literature. Is that correct? You've had no visits from the candidates. Is that correct? Have you?
Jack, you're coming in broken up. I can't hear your words clearly.
After all that work, I did.
Can I ask them a few questions?
One question.
Okay. First of all, what are they going to do for the north? Anything above Highway 37? There's nothing being done. Second of all, let's take radio and TV communication. In the new Charter of Rights, they say you have to have a population of 500 people. And yet when we wrote for grants for either TV or radio, they refused us. And to me, with the new Charter of Rights, that's discrimination. Also, what about allowances for the North?
Okay, hold on a second. Hold on. You'll hear me better in a minute. I'm sorry we have a bad line. They get BCIT up in that part of the world in Dees Lake, but they don't get any radio at all, as I understand. Are they entitled to...
Can we answer the man's question?
Yes.
Okay, because, I mean, we could let you ramble on to the end of the show, but we would like to answer...
It's a bad line, and I want him to hear, so answer in a loud voice.
Well, the Conservative Party will offer tax relief to Northerners. That is part of our costed package. It is in recognition of the fact, as an ex-resident of the Northwest Territories, I'm aware of this, it's in recognition of the fact that costs are much higher in the North. In addition, we have incentives for mining, and we have, in spite of Ed Broadbent's disclaimer, $130 million program for forestry. So We have resource incentives, and we have specific tax relief for Northerners to compensate them for their cost of living.
Iona?
There has been millions of federal dollars put into forest replenishment, and certainly in northeastern BC, where this gentleman is calling from, is the last 5% of Canadians who do not receive radio on a proper basis, who have great difficulty getting any telecommunication of any kind. And there has to be a vast expenditure of money. What they get is a CNCP line coming in there from which they draw off what they can. When I was MP for that area, I managed to get television into the town of Atherton, which is to the north of this town. It is an extremely difficult and costly venture. Obviously, there hasn't been strong representation from Mr. Fulton to further these projects that were there when I was the MP.
Jim Fulton has been an absolutely tremendous MP. He does pay attention to his riding, and it is he who has talked about northern benefits being reinstated. It's he who's talked about the excessive high cost of living. It is he and the New Democrats who have talked about a Ministry of Forestry. And the Conservatives came along the other day.
A big surprise to Frank Oberly.
And they never even mentioned, Brian Mulroney never even mentioned a Minister of Forestry, not in his statement the other day.
But you know, he has.
One promise broken before the elections even held.
It would help if Ed Broadbent actually read the material before dumping on it.
We read it.
Because we have $130 million in there for forestry.
No.
And also, Brian Mulroney has come out here several times, because I've attended the speeches, and maintained that there would be a Minister of Forestry. He made that promise, I believe, last January.
He said he was giving us an accounting.
Frank Oberly must be jumping up and down in Fitzgerald.
I am just so happy to see my good friends fighting over the scheme of riding. You know, there's a vestige of your heart stays with your former home, and I'm delighted they're going
to
do so much for the North.
As you know, that you know, you and I put satellite television into Dease Lake long before I went to politics.
True.
So
that's what we did, and that thing you were doing. I hope you had some of that, Mr. Barton, did you?
But there's one problem.
What's that?
What good is forestry up here when our trees wouldn't even make good toothpicks, let alone anything else?
Look, I'll give you a promise.
You've got to have trappers and big game hunters and people who are using the forest for leisure and for vacations.
Where is he? One of these days I'll get into Dease Lake to see you myself and come back with a proper report. And thanks for your call, Mr. Barton. Best I can do for you.
And we'll certainly have to improve the satellite link.
We're taking telephone calls. Go ahead, please, to my candidates. Pick your own target.
I'd like to ask Pat Carney three questions, and I'll hang up.
Right.
Okay, first, what old cronies have the Tories got rid of? What
old crony?
Uh-huh. Right.
What are they going to do about when they promised about getting rid of the metric system and bringing back the imperial system?
Okay.
Or are they going to raise the taxes like Joe Clark done and get defeated again?
Okay, thank you. What old cronies have the Tories got rid of? What's the question?
Well, I don't understand the question, since we won't be in power until Tuesday, and we won't be in a position to get rid of all coalies till
Tuesday. Are we still stuck with metric?
Our party position is that it should be a matter of choice. We should not have metric imposed on us by order and council as the Liberals did.
Oh my gosh, it should be a matter of choice. They voted for it. These Tories voted for metric conversion, and now they're having
about
conversion
the
on the road to
Damascus. In terms of the tax increase, no, we have no plans to increase taxes.
How about the October increase? Are you going to implement that?
Brian has said that we'll take a look at the books. That is a tax increase that the Liberals imposed 18 months ago when I was finance critic.
Are you going to keep it?
And Mr. Mulroney will say that, you know, we have to take a look at how bad the Liberals have left this nation.
You'll have to speak to your dinner partner, the 17th century man, Sinclair Stevens, about that.
After the break.
Well, I'd rather speak to this.
I have a correction to make, but Ms. Carney will make it.
No, I owe an apology to our candidate, Peter Weber, in Skeena. I'm running in the wrong election, or I'm fighting the wrong election on that, Peter. I'm sorry. Peter is from Hazleton, one of my favorite areas, and he is the Conservative candidate in Dease Lake.
We're sorry about that, Peter Weber. Weber, you've almost got a good name. If you just put an ST in there, it could be Peter Webster. Now, yeah, it's good enough. Weber's
pretty tired.
Well, he's a weaver, same as me. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'd like to ask a question to Pauline Jewett.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really concerned about if there's a change of government, that is a Tory government, that we'll lose our independence. And one of the things that Mulroney had said was that people who have a conscientious objection to the cruise missile, he once said that of this of them, he said, "I don't shake hands with Castro," and that's a hint that peace followers are commies. And now I'm really concerned. He's talked about ending the FIRA, and to me, this represents a total departure from the Diefenbaker tradition, where he sacrificed his government, really keeping the missiles out of Canada.
That's true.
And now there's a 180-degree switch, and it seems to me that Mulroney's in the pocket of Ronald Reagan, and I'm really concerned that Canada is going to lose its independence.
Okay, very well put indeed. Reagan being the man who joked the other day that he was outlawing Russia and they would nuke Moscow in 5 minutes or something. The bomb start in 5 minutes.
Pretty sick.
Do you want to set up, Pat?
Well, I think he's right that Mr. Diefenbaker, and indeed long before him, Sir John A. Macdonald, were pretty strong Canadian nationalists, and that the Tories have now really put themselves almost in the same position, if not a worse position than the Liberals, in tying themselves almost totally with United States policies. This is particularly true in the areas of military policies. We are producing components of nuclear weapons for the United States. We're tied into their decisions about testing the cruise. That was an American request, had nothing to do with NATO. And we are not really following through, he's quite right, on the wish to have Canada an independent power, have a mature state-to-state
what
relationship
you're saying
with the United States.
In other words, you think the Mulroney will become a lackey of Reagan?
I'm afraid so.
Well, of course, I couldn't disagree more with Pauline on this. Mr. Mulroney's position has always been is that we are the neighbors of the U.S. and we are best friends of the U.S. and if you maintain cordial relations, not confrontation the way the Liberals did, if you're talking to your neighbors and you're dealing with them in a cordial way, you're much more likely to change their minds and get the common goal of all parties, which is disarmament.
But he said you should give them the benefit of the doubt. He said, and St. Stephen said, you give the Americans always the benefit of the doubt.
We're always clobbering them.
That is not true. They are basically saying, and they're saying it on the nuclear freeze, if Reagan says no to it, then we'll say no to it.
That is not at all our position. And I don't see why. It's always the NDP who want to fight about peace.
Your leader is the one
who wants to fight about peace.
We are not fighting. We are trying to get
reason.
Okay. Reason should prevail.
I don't mind you making
your political
points.
You're going to give me some time, Jackery.
But I do object to your deliberately distorting Mr. Mulroney's
statement. Stop distorting, stop talking.
Okay, thank you.
Iona.
Brian Mulroney has been, from the very start, being very, very friendly toward the United States, because when I was campaigning in Central Nova, his campaign organizer stated that anyone who was in favor of peace was a commie, and that was commie business to be in favor of peace.
You should hear
that
what
was his
organizer. Say.
Just a minute, my dear friend, be quiet. And the other thing that bothers me about all this is liberals consider the United States our best friend too. And as best friends, we should sit with them and talk with them and argue with and for them for a better future. But it just annoys me no end when I see the Republican National Convention in Dallas putting a platform out for nuclear superiority against the Soviet Union, and the Republican government being the one that Mr. Mulroney felt needed another Irishman in North America to run the world. We've come to a time when we have actors playing the roles of leaders, and I think that's dangerous for the world.
Mind you, just to balance a little bit, Trudeau wasn't exactly the most diplomatic or friendly person to the United States and caused them a lot of unnecessary irritation.
This gentleman who called just now said he wanted Canada to be independent. Independent we have been. And I say Mr. Trudeau has been one of the great people to fight against that kind of gradual
joining. The Liberals haven't been independent any more than the Tories would be.
Indeed,
it's the Liberals that just said, we're ready, we'll test the cruise missile.
You're absolutely wrong. The cruise missile was the very least of the things
you're wrong about that. It was symbolic.
Okay, symbolic. We shall be again after the break. Well, at least one of these women will be a cabinet minister by next week sometime. I'm not saying which one. You can decide yourself if Dunn has flopped. if Mulroney's just another guy from the Far East who knows nothing about the West. And of course, the only one who can't get a job is Pauline. Isn't that right, Pauline?
No, maybe not this time, but next time I'll be in the cabinet, I hope.
Which party are you going to join?
The Democratic Party will be forming the government.
She's already been a Liberal and a New Democrat. That only leaves the Tories for her to join.
Perish the thought.
Good one. What up for Pat? Go ahead from Prince George.
Good morning, Ms. Webster and your political guest. I have some food of thought for your...
Carry on.
Okay, I got some food of thought for your guest. They have been talking some about high tech, but they haven't thought more in the future. To the extent that high tech has taken hold of this country, more and more people will be unemployed from high tech, and only a few will be re-employed or retrained. Why don't they give some thought that all levels of politics, management, and unions get together and think of somehow they could satisfy everybody's basic needs of a roof over their head, food on their back, and food in their tummies. If they could solve this problem, then you could solve the need for work a little easier.
Okay, he's saying to you, supply basic shelters to all the myriad of unemployed of Canadians in the future. I suspect he's being cynical.
No, I think he is being, I think he is, no. I think he's expressing the wish of most Canadians, which is that...
To be slobs?
No, what they want out of their governments, collective governments, is the chance to earn a living and provide food on the table and shelter for their families.
But Canadians.
But I just want to dispute. I'm not a pessimist about high tech. Our party has promised to double our research and development expenditures in this country, which the National Research Council says will create 400,000 jobs. And we have a major emphasis on training.
Don't hog it.
Yesterday's cuts in promises, reneging on promises by Pat's leader, included the no inclusion of R&D. The problem is that the Canadian people are far ahead of the Canadian politicians in understanding the nature of the post-industrial revolution and what it means to us. Obviously, we have to spend money the way the Japanese have for development of a fifth-generation computer and then find our people in the service sector to serve all those.
You would endorse that, roughly speaking.
Yes, and one reason Japan has had such a high growth rate is that it hasn't devoted any of its brains or money into producing military goods.
Or any of its women.
Consumer-oriented. Yeah.
Go ahead, please. Go ahead, please. No, go ahead, please.
Yeah, Jack?
Yep.
Yeah, I have a very complex question to ask the three particular parties there.
Yes?
Regarding yesterday, when you were talking to Ed Broadman about prostitutes, one of the main problems of Vancouver.
Yes?
What I was wondering is, I know Pat Carney is running Vancouver Centre, and I was wondering, to the other two parties, as well as Pat Carney, if they were to gather all the prostitutes together throughout the Lower Mainland to have an individual discussion with the prostitutes, how would they get the prostitutes to vote for their party through their policies that would help them achieve no longer wanting to be prostitutes and better their lives?
I don't think that's really a very valid or a terribly sensible question. I don't think any one of the women here is campaigning on that particular list to get prostitutes from the street people who have presently been banned from the West End by Chief Justice McKechnie. I think we should just leave that where it lies, that question. Would you agree, ladies?
Well, he's acting as if women want to be prostitutes. If there were economic equity in this country, I don't think very many people would choose that as a lifestyle.
There are lots of male prostitutes down there. I think it runs out now to about 50-50.
But it's
a basic economic problem first.
It's a social problem
which has been allowed to be developed by our disinterested, too permissive society, which won't take the elementary steps, and I'll exclude
Jack,
all adults to protect children.
How many human beings do you think would choose that life if they had a better choice?
I'm just saying to protect children.
I agree.
These children should have been removed on all occasions from that.
The House of Commons Justice Committee report, which the Liberals refused to implement and the NDP refused to support, made special provision for the protection of children. But the Conservatives are the only people with a clean record on that. It was our proposal. It was adopted by the All-Party Justice Committee with the exception of the NDP.
We're opening
and the Liberals
gamut.
Were too chicken.
No.
You go to violence, you go to pornography.
Don't give me that stuff. Let me ask you each a simple question. Do you believe that a 12 or 13-year-old child in trouble on the streets there should be lifted off the streets and put in a secure environment for some kind of love, care, and rehabilitation?
You could not deny that, of course.
Could, nobody
yes,
could.
I,
it
yes,
is not being done. No. Do you believe that we should have a simple amendment?
Because the BC government has canceled all those kinds of homes and assistance and being interim funded by the federal government.
True. Now we go to the other one. Do you support a simple amendment to the criminal code to make soliciting by male or female or drag queen hookers or action by Johns to make simple soliciting an offense for which the police can arrest? You don't.
Not in the criminal code.
No, you don't. It just appalls me. You.
So long as the male is, or I the guess. Customer you support is also part
yes.
of it.
Yes, you.
Of course, that we recommended that, but we never got the support of the Liberal government. We never got the support of the NDP.
They didn't pass the
You're bill. One of my favorite people. I don't know why you take that position. I just don't understand you. The greatest good of the greatest number is surely the very basis of a democracy.
Of course it is, but not through the criminal code.
How are you going to do it?
Of course you can do it through other means, just as you can most other measures, most social measures. We manage to handle in our society without making criminal offenses out of something that is fundamentally a social problem.
Thank you, ma'am. My grateful thanks to Pauline Jewett, my grateful thanks to Iona Campagnola, and also to Pat Carney. Trust that all goes well the way you wish on election night.
Thank you, Jack.
I'll be working.
And I shall be back. It was fun doing your show.
Thank you very much.
We did all the work for it.
Yeah.
You know, you cut off easy today.
Don't kid yourself. It's only because I like you. After the break. Tomorrow we've got Joe Clark, used to be PM. Tomorrow we'll also have Jill Turner. Tomorrow we'll have 10 of the independents running in Quadra, just to give you a flavor of some of the other campaign platforms. I'll run them separately. Couldn't get a word in Edgeway today. We'll be back tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. Mrs. Carney, Campagnola, and Jewett on check at midnight. The PM's wife, Jill Turner, with Webster at 9 a.m. precisely.